Simon & Schuster Audio presents Upheaval by Lou Dobbs. Read by the author.
Author's note. American history is filled with glory and victory, great achievements, a nation of stalwarts and heroes who discovered a new world, tamed wild frontiers, whose proud citizens won wars, fought, bought, bargained, and traded and built the United States. The world's greatest constitutional republic, its freest society, its most expansive, productive, and wealthiest economy. Only Americans have set foot on the moon, and Americans have explored deeper in space than any other people. But we haven't returned to the moon in four decades, and we have to catch rides with the Russians to get back to the International Space Station. We build less than we once did on our little patch of Earth. We're told by our elites in business, media, and politics that we're too smart, too knowledgeable to do physical labor. We're told that manual labor jobs are jobs that Americans won't do, that we have mysteriously acquired some inexplicable privilege not to sweat. But apparently, in acquiring the right not to sweat, many of us have been convinced to give up our right to secure our borders, to decide whom we will confer citizenship upon from among all the citizens of the world. Our president and his acolytes, in oh-so-dour words and tone, tell us effectively that part-time work is good enough for Americans. High unemployment and slow economic growth are simply the new Obama normal. America is now a vast conundrum. There is festering frustration among the wealthy, the poor, and the middle class. The American dream has become more elusive as millions of Americans struggle to become middle class, and millions more struggle to hold their places in the middle class. Our elites seem knowingly intent on tearing up social contracts that have held our society together through decades of rapid social and economic change. And what are the values that we share as a people? Those values were once thrift, efficiency, faith, community, ingenuity, straight talk, honesty, industriousness. All values that once defined us and the American way. But increasingly, those values are eroding and being replaced by complacency, even hopelessness and indifference, as expanding, encroaching government influences and in some cases controls the lives of citizens under the guise of protecting and providing for them. Ours has become a dependent nation, whose society ever less frequently hears the words independence and self-reliance. The broad social contract with which America has prospered and prevailed for 2.5 centuries seems at times to have been discarded a bit at a time without notice or discussion, and perhaps to never be restored. Relationships between government and the governed, between employers and the employed, between teachers and their citizens are strained, disrupted, and in some instances ended altogether. Our aspirations as Americans are not just frustrated, but too often many of our fellow citizens no longer have faith in their ability to achieve educational, financial, political, and societal goals and ideals that were once shared broadly in our country. Of late, we frequently hear that if we surrender just one more liberty, surrender one more element of our independence, we'll be secure from the forces from without, from the anger and hostility of radical Islamist terrorists who mean to destroy us, or in time, the rising power of the People's Republic of China, or North Korea, and Iran, Al-Qaeda, and the Taliban, or some combination of these. All of which represent challenges, threats, or potential threats to American lives or living standards to one degree or another, whether as economic competitors or truly extant threats to the American nation. America has experienced great upheaval and struggle throughout our history. The number of wars we fought, the very construction of our government, prejudices most Americans to think of threats primarily as coming from nation-states and our vulnerabilities to be primarily to external forces handled by the Department of State, Department of Defense, our President, the Commander-in-Chief. But I believe our principal vulnerability and the chief threats to the stability of our social order and economic well-being, indeed the very essence of our American way of life, go well beyond leagues of nation-states and ideologues who mean us harm. The greatest threat of upheaval is a combination of those nation-states, ideological extremists, religious zealots, and the confluence of internal forces that are weakening our notion of who we are, diminishing our confidence in the American dream itself, and leaving many of our citizens and many of our leaders questioning American exceptionalism, our way of life, and our relationship to one another and to the world itself. The very idea of America is under great stress from within and without. The prospect of a great upheaval rises with each passing day that we decline to examine the consequences of the choices we're making as a people and as a nation. And these forces are allied not in conspiracy, but in their contemporaneous array against us, our ideals, our values, and our nation's future. It is no wonder that many Americans possess an enlarged sense of entitlement. We have prevailed in war, scientific and technological achievement, and economic success, and have created the freest, most prosperous society on the planet. We're far from perfect, and the truth is that we Americans tend to believe that the laws of cause and effect are sometimes suspended on our behalf. We've been careless in choosing those who will lead and represent us, and we've been careless in our disregard for the consequences of the public policy choices that Washington has made. We've elected in succession three presidents, unencumbered by any significant knowledge of international relations or practice in foreign policy. We have permitted the outsourcing of millions of jobs and the offshoring of thousands upon thousands of factories and plants to cheaper markets without regard to jobs or capital lost to our home economy. And we've actually listened to our elite's rhetoric about the need for highly educated, highly skilled immigrants, which of course is true, but those same elites have spent their energy and more than $1.5 billion in lobbying money to bring in mostly unskilled and uneducated illegal immigrants. We've watched the Federal Reserve shore up our six largest commercial banks, while those same banks have spent more than $100 billion on attorney and litigation fees and in settlements of improper lending and mortgage foreclosures since the 2008 financial crisis. And we hear hardly a word in our national liberal media about our students' poor performance in mathematics, science, engineering, and technology, or the result of allowing as many as one-third of our high school students to drop out. We have ignored too often the consequences of the public policy choices that contribute to such outcomes when what we must do is look at the facts and understand fully that the laws of cause and effect have not been rescinded in America, and those facts are pretty good guideposts for all of us. Perhaps that explains why one of the most popular segments on my show, Lou Dobbs Tonight, is what we call the Chalk Talk. Each weekday evening on the Fox Business Network, I stand in front of an old-fashioned blackboard and spend 3 to 5 minutes scribbling and scrawling numbers and words all over that blackboard, talking about the critical issues that face us all. My audience loves the sweep of subjects we take up, subjects that are often larger stories than the headlines of the day, more important to the well-being of our audience, more important to the country. And the blackboard I use may seem a little familiar. My producers went searching through the Fox News storage warehouse in an undisclosed location and discovered an old blackboard. They brushed off the cobwebs, blew off the dust, and carried it back to Studio F, where we've put it to work. This ancient audiovisual artifact even has a legend, perhaps more a myth that accompanies it. It is said that a fellow named Glenn Beck once used it. I don't know whether the legend or the stories are true, but no matter. I enjoy using the low-tech device each evening, and we have a lot of fun with it. Sometimes serious fun. The blackboard helps prove each night that detail and facts and statistics don't have to be fancy to explain the core of any issue, and they certainly don't have to be dull. I have the advantage of having one of the smartest audiences in television, which makes these chalk talks fun for the audience and fun for me. There will be more than a few chalk talks in the pages ahead as we focus on the nature of the potential upheaval we face as a nation, and the axis of forces and powers that seek to end the great American experiment and the American dream. Introduction. June 10th, 1991. That's the date we celebrated our military's victory over Iraqi forces in Kuwait and Iraq. We celebrated with a ticker tape parade in New York City. It was a thrilling sight, confetti and ribbons raining down upon our troops as they marched proudly through the Canyon of Heroes. My family and I were among the estimated 4.5 million people who stood on the sidewalks of New York that day to cheer our troops and their leader, General Norman Schwarzkopf. There was lots of brass there that day. General Colin Powell, Secretary of Defense Cheney, the mayor, of course, David Dinkins. But like most New Yorkers, my attention was focused on our troops, our flag, and the hero general who had made short work of repulsing Saddam Hussein's invasion of Kuwait and driving his forces beyond Basra back to Baghdad. Americans had much to celebrate that day: a decisive military victory, courageous and brilliant leadership, the fact that America's leaders had chosen not to press a victorious campaign into a full-on invasion and occupation of Iraq. America's restraint was all the more remarkable because the only limits to our global power were imposed by our values, our judgment, and our leaders' understanding that power is often greatly magnified and leveraged by the careful application of that power. With the collapse of Marxist-Leninism and the Soviet Union, the United States stood as the world's only superpower, and by God, we were acting like it. But it has always been strange to me that we never threw a parade for those who fought and struggled to secure the biggest victory of all, the winning of the Cold War. It would have been quite something to have celebrated all that America and our allies accomplished over the course of almost a half century of Cold War and military conflict from Korea to Vietnam, and ceaseless covert engagement throughout the world between the United States and the Soviet Union. At least we finally got around to honoring our Korean War veterans with a parade in New York 2 weeks after the Gulf War parade. Have we really become a people who no longer want to celebrate our military, the achievement of our national goals? Are we a people who don't want to be reminded of all we owe our military and our intelligence agencies who protect our nation each and every day? Is there now something so overwhelmingly politically incorrect about patriotism that we can't celebrate our heroes, those who achieve, those who sacrifice and serve our great nation? Many of us are old enough to remember when our military marched in Independence Day parades everywhere around the country each July 4th. So when's the last time you stood on a curb or sidewalk and thrilled at the sight of our troops marching proudly with our flag down Main Street or 8th Avenue or whichever street is the center of your town, your city? We've moved quite a ways over the years from those parades. I don't really know why. Did somebody make a decision and forget to tell us? Is there some reason we would not want our youngsters to thrill at the sight of our men and women in uniform, to watch our flag held high as we stand together as citizens, saluting all it stands for? Who made that decision, and why have we let it stand? And why are we moving away from singing the praises of God for His bountiful blessings upon us and our beautiful...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.